What's up, guys? Brian here in the Gecko Lab, and today we are going to discuss six things you need before you get your first gecko. Now, this is going to be part one of a two-part series, so don't forget to check back to our channel for next weekend's six more things you need before you get your first gecko. Go ahead and hit that subscribe button, like this video. You don't want to miss out on any of these. One quick note before we get into the first item on today's list. If you check the description box down below, I've posted links to where you can purchase every item featured on today's list. So if you're looking to get a gecko soon and you're starting to collect everything you're going to need, check that description box, links for everything. Let's get straight into it. Item number one. Now, number one on our list today is pretty obvious, and that's your cage. You're gonna get a gecko, you gotta have somewhere to put it, and the two most popular cages we see are the Zoomed and Exoterra. Now, here we have a Zoomed 12 by 12 by 18 inch cage. Exoterra makes a very similar one to this. This is the smallest of size you'd wanna put one adult gecko in. Even better than this would be an 18 by 18 by 24 inch cage. Zoomed and Exoterra both make a version of that as well. Now, glass cages aren't the only way you can go. Plastic tubs and acrylic plastic cages also work very nicely. However, most people prefer these glass ones. They look good. They're real great for display. They make all kinds of accessories that go on top, lights, vines, all kinds of stuff. These are a great option. You can find them at any pet store, and links down below, of course, if you're interested in picking one up. Number two on our list today is substrate. You've got your cage, you need something to line the bottom. That's where substrate comes in. Now, there's two different trains of thought when it comes to substrate, either a naturalistic substrate or an artificial substrate. Now, the upside to an artificial substrate, which most people is either paper towels or newspapers, what a lot of people use. There are some companies that make, they call it Repti carpet. It's like AstroTurf that goes in the bottom of the cage. Don't worry about that stuff. It's crap. Artificial substrate, just use either paper towels or newspaper. It's simple, it's easy, it's cheap. That's the upside. Easy to clean. You can clean the cage more often. It doesn't cost you much money. It's real simple. The downsides, for one, it's ugly. You got this stuff lying in the bottom of your cage. Does not look very good if that's important to you. But more importantly to that, to your geckos, artificial substrate does not hold humidity very well. So if you live in a dry climate like I do here in Colorado, you either have to spray your cages more often, put a humidifier in the room, or you have to have a humid hide in there. That's another good way to combat it. Those are the pros and cons. Artificial substrate can be very useful. On the other hand, a naturalistic substrate, I prefer shredded cocoa fiber. It comes like this in a compressed brick. You can also get it loose in a bag. I prefer the bricks. Soak it in water. I've used it a bunch. You guys have seen it a bunch. I'm sure you know how it works. Put about an inch and a half of this at the bottom of your cage. It's a little more time intensive to clean and switch it out, but it holds a lot of humidity. So when you spray your cage, this will soak up all that humidity, release it over time, makes for a happy gecko, and it also looks a lot better. So those are your two main options for substrate. Number two on our list today. All right, we are cruising right on to item number three on our list today, and that is food, because geckos gotta eat. Now, there's a wide variety of crested gecko diets available on the market. And unfortunately, not all of them are good for your geckos. There's quite a few cheap diets made with bad ingredients that just aren't good for your animals. So I've put six together here today that I would recommend are good for your animals. I recommend feeding these six diets. Let's go through them real quick. First up, we got the two big guys, Rapashi and Pangea. These are by far the most common and most popular brands. They both make a variety of different flavors and formulas for different situations and different geckos. I personally feed these two. They're great diets. You cannot go wrong. I'm sure most of you have heard about these. Great diets, Rapashi and Pangea. Also, the Zoomed diet. You guys might remember a couple years ago, I did a complete crested gecko diet review video where I reviewed every diet that was available on the market at that time, and I ripped Zoomed a new one. Their diet was terrible at that point. Terrible. But big props to them. After that video came out, Zoomed actually hit me up. They sent me an email. They said, hey, we saw your video. We're formulating a new diet. We would like you to be one of our testers. So they sent me a ton of this. I did a whole review video on it. I fed it pretty extensively to my collection. It's a good diet. They really did a great job the second time around, listening to customer feedback and making a solid, healthy diet for the geckos. Props to Zoomed. Also, Big Fat Gecko Diet. I have not fed this one personally, but I've heard really good things about it, and I'm confident that it's a good diet. Being in your feeding rotation is a good idea. There's also the Leap and Lychee's diet, another one that I have not fed personally, but I hear very good things about. Steve Somelli at Leap and Lychee's is an incredibly intelligent guy. I have a lot of faith in this diet. It would be good in your breeding, your feeding rotation. And lastly, Black Panther Zoological. I have fed this diet myself. It's not part of my normal rotation, but I have fed it. Solid diet, good guys over there. I recommend that one as well. My last note on diets, I prefer a feeding rotation. I don't buy just one flavor of Pangea and feed it to my geckos. I buy four different flavors of Pangea and four different flavors of Rapashi, and I feed them on rotation. I think it helps keep the geckos engaged when the flavors get changed up here and there. So buy a couple small bags of a couple different brands or different flavors of one brand, whatever you're comfortable with. But this is the six companies I would recommend you get a diet from. Number four on our list today, we're going to stick with the theme of food, and we're going to talk about crickets and, more importantly, gut loading your crickets. A good gut load is imperative to healthy geckos. Now, a lot of people hear that crested geckos don't need to eat crickets, and that's true. They can be healthy without getting crickets, but they are healthier when they eat crickets. Some geckos won't take live animals, they won't eat live insects, and that's perfectly fine. If your gecko prefers not to eat live, there's nothing wrong with that. Stick with a good complete diet, your gecko's gonna be fine. But for most geckos, and especially if you're looking to breed your geckos, feeding crickets is pretty important. And the most important part of feeding crickets that's always overlooked is a gut load. When I was first keeping reptiles, about 15 years ago, I had a leopard gecko that I took to the vet just to get a checkup on and learn some things. And one of the things that my vet told me that I still remember to this day was he asked me how long I gut load my crickets for. And I told him, well, they put some gut load in the bag when I buy them at the store, so I figured they're good. And he told me, no, they're only gut loading for about half an hour when you do that. Minimum, they need to gut load for 3 days. Your crickets should gut load for 3 days. And the way he explained it to me made a lot of sense. He said, if you think about it, these crickets are mass produced at a big cricket farm. They're raised on the cheapest ingredients. They're not very healthy animals. When you gut load with a healthy diet, even with a super healthy gut load diet for even one night, all you're doing is filling that animal's belly with healthy food and then feeding it to your animal. You want to gut load your crickets for a minimum of 3 days so they have time to ingest food, metabolize it, build their bodies up, ingest more food, metabolize it, build up, and in 3 days they become bigger, healthier, juicier, solid, nutritional crickets for your geckos. It's super important, and I noticed a huge difference when I started gut loading my crickets versus just buying them at the store and feeding them off. On the note of gut loads, there's two good ones on the market that I highly recommend. Pangea has one called Pig. It is Pangea insect grub. It's you mix it with water, hot water, and it kind of forms into a gel brick. Feed that to your insects. It provides food and water together. And also, I don't have any of it on me to show you, but Rapashi makes one called Rapashi Bug Burger. That's what I personally use. I've got some of the Pangea. Normally I use the Rapashi just because that's what I started with and I'm used to it and I've had great results with it. Rapashi Bug Burger, fantastic gut load for your crickets. You definitely want to grab some of that for big healthy crickets that make big healthy geckos. Coming in at number five on our list today is a humid hide. Now, we talked a little bit about humidity earlier and how it's important for your geckos to have proper humidity. It helps them shed, it keeps them healthy, it prevents any respiratory issues. Proper humidity is real important for crested geckos. Now, with some cages with a screen top, if you live in a dry area, if you're using a screen-sided cage, lots of different things can contribute to the humidity in your gecko's cage being too low. There's lots of ways to combat that, put a humidifier in your room, spray the cage down more often. But one good way to help prevent any issues is to provide your geckos with a humid hide. It gives them a nice humid place to go sit when they feel like they need a little bit more humidity, and the geckos know they will use it. A lot of times you'll even see geckos bury themselves in the substrate in the humid hide because they just want to hang out where it's a little cooler and a little more humid. Now, there's two good ways to go about this. You can buy a pre-made reptile cave similar to this one. just something real simple. They make all kinds of different caves and hides like this. Something that opens up, you can fill it with a substrate, put the lid on, it's got a hole for your gecko to get in. Real cool looking decor piece, and your geckos will appreciate it. The DIY option, I have a whole video on this. Check the link in the description below for the video. I use them as lay boxes for breeding females, but it's the same thing as a humid hide. It's just a Tupperware container, hole cut in the top. And for the substrate, I use the cocoa fiber and I mix it with play sand. It breaks up the cocoa fiber a little, it holds water a little better, it makes it easier for the geckos to dig into it. If they swallow it, it's not that big of a deal, contrary to popular belief. When females are laying eggs, they constantly swallow a bunch of this when they're digging down to lay eggs. Doesn't bother them. I've never once had an issue. Works great. That's what I would recommend putting in your humid hide, cocoa fiber mixed with play sand. Check out my lay box video for instructions on how to do that exactly. But humid hides, super important, and it's definitely something you're gonna wanna consider picking up if you're consider picking up a gecko. All right, guys, we have made it to the final item on our list today, number 6. But real quickly, don't forget, smash that subscribe button because you're not going to want to miss next week's video. 6 more things you're going to want to pick up before you get your first crested gecko. But enough of that talk. Let's get to the last item. Number 6 is a temperature/humidity gauge. We just talked about humid hides, substrate, spraying the cage. How do you know what the humidity in your cage is, and how do you know if your gecko's comfortable? Crested geckos like a temperature range between 68 and 78 degrees. They can tolerate extremes above or below that on either side, but that's kind of your sweet spot, and you need to know if your gecko's happy. Easiest way to do that, temperature and humidity gauge. I like this one from ZooMed. It's digital, so it's real easy to read. It's got a probe in the back. I will show you. So this is great. It's got a digital readout, a long cord, and a humidity gauge, and a temperature probe. So you just stretch these out, suction cup them right to the side of your cage, and then this sits on the outside. It's even got a screw hole in the back so you can mount it on the wall next to your cage. It's perfect. It gives you a constant readout. What's your humidity level at? What's your temperature level at? You know if you need to make any adjustments. You know if your gecko's happy. It's one of the easiest ways to make sure your gecko's habitat is proper and if they're comfortable, and that is key to having a good, happy pet gecko. Well, everybody, that is it. That's our list for today. 6 things you're gonna wanna pick up before you get your first gecko. I really, really appreciate you watching. Thank you so much. Don't forget, altitudeexotics.com, facebook.com/AEGeckos. Same thing for Instagram. Follow us, I appreciate it, and I will see you all soon. Thank you. Thank you.